Welcome to the anime and simulcast discussion podcast, Divergence Cast, every people of the universe. I am one of your hosts, Galaxy S4, also known as JJ. I'm joined by one of those very old Nokia brick phones, Stranger. And, according to him at least, a very butt phone, Alex.
Ring ring.
And today we shall talk once more about anime and probably have a phone call from Alex. Okay, let's start off with our weeks. So, how about you, Alex?
Finally beat Deus Ex. Yeah, I've been playing that pretty much nonstop for like the last 2 weeks. Yeah. And alongside that, started started Oddworld Stranger's Wrath and Misplosion Man.
So
I still haven't touched Fable in about a week.
I'll
get back to it tonight.
Yeah,
I'll get back to it tonight.
So on Deus Ex, did you do all the endings or did you just choose one?
I wound up getting all three endings, but at first I was like really confused about which ending to go with.
Yeah. So,
I told you to go for the one with best waifu.
But the one I wound up getting first is probably the shittiest one. It's the what's his name? JC merges with Helios.
Yeah. Which is funny because that kind of made me think of Ghost in the Shell movie a bit, sort of.
And then after that, I decided to just get the other two endings. And other than that.
Yeah. I never really thought highly of the endings of the game. I mean, I enjoyed the story altogether, but
I'd actually say Human Revolution suffers the same problem.
Yeah, definitely.
That sort of like gives you three choices. At least in the original Deus Ex, you're doing something.
Yeah.
And Human Revolution, you're just given three screens to choose which ending you want.
It's pretty much button press.
Yeah, but I'd overall say I actually like the Everett ending, or whatever, the Illuminati ending. That's actually probably the most complete ending of three.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I didn't really care much for the Helios ending. Yeah. The Stone Age ending was okay.
Yeah.
And then probably thought the Illuminati ending was best. I mean, other than that...
Well, supposedly there's also a fourth ending, but I think all it is like a weird dance party scene or something.
So it's pretty much just JC doing the boogaloo or something like that?
No, it's just a bunch of character models doing the weird dance with the animation. I've seen the video of it, but it's probably not worth getting.
Well, like I said, I've been playing nothing but that for like the last 2 weeks or so. And really good game. Really good game.
Yeah.
And, other than that, I've just been checking out a few new, watching simulcasts and checking out a few new shows. I started Adakawa Under the Bridge last night and the Ghost Stories dub as well.
Yeah.
And that's about it.
Yeah. Mainly just been playing some more Valkyria Chronicles and Star Trek Online and keeping up with simulcast, and I also started a series called The 12 Kingdoms, which I've been liking a lot so far. And that's pretty much about it for me. How about you, Stranger?
Let's see, other than playing more Rewrite, got back in a Civ mood the other night and played it for like 6 hours straight. That happens from time to time. And then, other than that, the only thing I've watched this week that wasn't a simulcast was a single episode of Gunbuster.
All right. Anything else? All right. Nope. Let's move on to simulcast then. So, first up, Log Horizon. It was a pretty good lead-in episode for the, going to be for next episode, I thought. Very much going into the traditional, the usual stuff with the series where it sort of leads up, does a couple build-up episodes right before it really unleashes something really cool, I think. But it also very much improved Akatsuki's character development, it's definitely gotten better the last couple of episodes since that first one. And there was also some pretty nice foreshadowing in the episode for the next, like, for example, did you see the flavor text for that, the other sword?
Like, yeah, how it eats armor and weapons.
Yeah. I thought that was a nice little detail to throw in.
Mm-hmm. So, I was actually just wondering, when do you think we'll find out the flavor text? Did they mention the flavor text of the scythe?
No, I don't think so. She just said it had some pretty dark flavor text, but mm-hmm. I don't remember seeing anything about it. But when they, I imagine once they finish up the storyline and eventually start getting to what happened to Rusty, they'll probably talk about it. Yeah. Anything else about this week's episode?
I'm not gonna lie, I'm getting kind of tired of the characters they've been focusing on the last few weeks.
Mm.
I just want them to get back to Shiroe and the raid.
Yeah.
Like, here's the thing, well, I've liked every episode a lot better than episode 4, because that's probably the absolute low point of this season so far. But I'll sort of agree with Stranger, like, while the episode's current arc doesn't bother me that much anymore, I'm really...
Yeah.
Waiting for just them to go back to the raids.
Back
to the raid, because I was like, you know, to start the season off on that, and then just sort of slow it down. It's just like...
Yeah, and it felt like they really were in the middle of it, and then they go shift over to this. It felt really weird.
It's like... And plus, especially to start off the arc with the way they did with episode 4, with Akatsuki just pitting herself half the time.
Yeah.
Was just like... I don't know. It's just like I said, I'm enjoying it now.
Yeah.
There's obviously some fun stuff that's probably about to happen, but I'm with Stranger in that I'm looking forward to when they get back to the raid.
Well, yeah, I imagine they'll be ending this arc in either the next episode or the one after, and then they'll probably either go back to Rusty Shiro, and or start focusing on what happened to Rusty.
Yeah, and. That's not to say I don't like elements of the that were introduced in the last episode. I like the whole thing of the like weapons attributes sort of actually starting to take effect as if they're like in real life now.
Mm.
So I like that whole thing.
Yeah, it's making like you more cautious on the weapons you pick up. Like now, even if it is a really good or powerful weapon. The characters will probably be more suspicious of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And go ahead.
I think the main thing that's been annoying me about this arc is it just keeps hammering in, accept your weakness, power of friendship.
Yeah.
Which surprisingly, given my distaste for the constant use of, you know, friendship tropes in anime, I'm surprised I'm actually still tolerating it.
Yeah.
Just like we're all surprised you're still tolerating me, Sekor.
I stick with it because of the comedy, man. Not like the honesty, but just like, you know, I don't see how you get by on like the character relationships because there's like nothing. It's like, do I like him? Does she like me? And all that. It's fucking irritating. Have you watched the OVA yet?
No. I'm saving it until I want more Nisekoi. Gonna be soon, I feel it.
Go ahead.
I sort of forgot what I was gonna say about Log Horizon anyway.
Okay. I was just going to say, is there anything else to talk about Log Horizon? You want to talk about it,
Nah, I got nothing.
Nope.
Alright, I guess we can skip Rage of Bahamut this week since it was just cut together a review episode. Sort of.
I didn't even bother with it. My brother told me about it. I was like,
I got.
He actually just watched the episode and just for it to hear the song, and they actually put the actual lyrics apparently.
Yeah, I did notice that actually. I got to that point and then I sort of stopped.
Oh, and also apparently it's supposed to be one core.
Well, I'm sure.
I thought it was important, but at the same time, like I would say to this point, they seem to be know what they're doing so far with it. Yeah. So it's not gonna.
And
unless,
who knows?
Unless it ends sort of in a way like Mukaku City Actors or Terran Resonance does. I sort of think it's probably, I think.
Yeah, I think I remember hearing a couple weeks ago that the DVD over in Japan has had, like, the highest pre-orders, that higher than Shirobako in that month or so.
It had higher than Fate Stay Night.
Yeah, so I imagine, honestly.
And here's the thing, even if it doesn't end on a satisfying note, it seems popular enough that they could bring it back for another season or so.
Plus, the game is
huge.
It's basically a money-making machine, so they could honestly put money into it regardless and not really be too damaged by it. But, let's see. I guess moving on, Gugure Kokkuri-san. So, what do you think?
The part at the beginning.
Oh, God.
She's pretty much, you know, the cat girl, whatever her name is. Tama, is it?
I think so.
How she's just, you know, convinced that Gohina's a doll, and then it's like, it's all well and good. You just regard her as a freak, and then she fucking starts looking under Gohina's dress and smelling. And it's like, oh my God. It's like, and it's just amazing that, you know, this show just manages shocking. And it's like, I was amazed. I was amazed when they did that part, and
I wasn't that surprised. But honestly, this series is this season's Sabagabu, basically.
It's like, it just, the things this show manages to get away with.
Yeah,
it's just, oh my God. I just saw that part. I'm like, whoa. Because here's the thing, you know, you have Inugami, who, you know, he's a pervert and everything, but hasn't really done anything like that. Here he just had this random cat lady that's obsessed with dolls, and she's, like, looking under her 5-year-old's dress, for God's sake. It's like, oh, man. But especially on that first chapter, one thing I will say that I loved about is how, you know, while the three guys are trying to, you know, Inugami, Kokkuri, and the, I can't remember his name, the Tanuki?
Yeah.
They're trying to figure out how to get Kohina out of the cat's house, and then she just winds up pretty much working her own way out.
Yeah.
Pretty much just kicking the cat lady's, Tama's ass, essentially. She, like, traps her, and then, like, what is it she does again?
A circle of balls of water.
I don't really get that. Is that supposed to be, like, holy water implied or something?
I don't know, but I remember them doing it with the first cat, and for some reason that worked. I don't know.
And then the second half of the
show. Oh yeah,
so it was funny because, you know, Kokkuri once again turned into a woman. And I just found it hilarious how the Tanuki at first is like just in love, and then you gradually see he's just gonna stay the scumbag he is anyway.
Yeah, and the whole thing at the beginning of that part with the curse, where it's like, don't open this box, and it's like, seriously, don't open it.
And then you opened it, LOL. And then he just gets pissed, and Gohina tells him that, you know, her family has a habit of just being assholes, and you have to, like, hold the paper a certain way to see how to undo the curse.
Yeah. And the whole commenting on how he and, like, the commenting in the first arc, how he's only handsome in his backstory, Kokkuri. And then in the second part, where she comments on how his only actual character trait is he's a dude who likes to do housework. And even that,
Kohina was just sharp. So.
Just tearing him apart.
And then just even more, this shows how little she cares at the end. It's like, meanwhile, Kohina was focused on the piece of leek that was stuck in her teeth.
Yeah.
And it's to be continued right after that.
Yeah, and in general, the female Kokkuri-san's character design somehow made me, for some reason, it made me think of Kaganai as far as the character design is concerned, and I'm not quite sure why. Just, I don't know.
I like the thing you just tweeted out, Stranger.
What did you just, what?
It's a Titan thing, pretty much. What's the big Titan called?
Colossal Titan.
Yeah, he's just giving the middle finger when he just stuck him on a wall. But back to the anime.
Yeah. But yeah, I don't know. It's just the art style, the way she's drawn compared to the other characters, it made me think of Haganai's art style a little bit. But let's see, what else? What else did I have to comment? I think that's all I had, actually. Anything else about Gugure Kokkuri-san this week?
Not that I can think of.
Alright, let's see, moving on. Amagi Brilliant Park.
So, that was a pretty forgettable episode, in my opinion.
Yeah, felt like a bit more of a fillerish sort of episode to me.
Yeah, it's like, I'm just watching it, it's like, my brother told me about it, I was like, how bad can it be? And it felt if anything loosely related to the rest of like the story so far.
Yeah, I thought
just,
it was still
just a general thing. I would say it was actually in terms of humor wasn't even that good either.
Yeah, but I still thought it was pretty fun, honestly. And this whole thing with the
I thought the shark guy was hilarious.
Yeah.
But otherwise, I just thought it was a boring episode.
Yeah, I didn't think it was boring, but. Yeah, I all agree. It definitely wasn't.
It's sort of like memorable. The whole it's like the Log Horizon situation on a smaller scale, where, you know, with Log Horizon, you start out with like this kick-ass arc, and then go to one that's sort of like meh.
Yeah.
And then they have pretty much every episode of Amagi Brilliant Park so far seems to have, you know, devoted itself to some form of story, and then you just introduce this filler.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it just sort of confused me.
I'd call it, like, decent, but after all the episodes before were freaking amazing, it's kind of disappointing.
I mean, nothing could stay perfect forever, but, I mean, that was just... Yeah, it was just such a... It was just, like, such an... To me, I was, like, just watching, it's, like... I went from, like, sort of interested at the beginning, and then just, like, gradually throughout the episode, it's, like, I wish this was done already. Easily the most dull episode.
I really can't think of anything else to comment about it, really, but,
Especially coming after the staff episode, too. It's like, man.
Oh, yeah, I suppose, yeah, it's pretty disappointing after...
You come from arguably one of the best episodes so far, and then you get delivered last week's episode, and it's like, ugh.
Well, I'm sure it'll come back.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess moving on from that, have you watched today's episode or just last week's episode of Denki-Gai?
I watched it.
So, let's see, do you want to comment on both or just this week's episode?
I'm trying to remember what happened last week.
Yeah, might as well just comment on this week's episode then. So, let's see... I didn't write anything down, so, what do you think of the episode?
I love the part with Foo Girl.
That
beats
was...
up the zombie. Just beats...
That was a callback to the episode before with Selma Larry and the one cat and the bikers, but now it's like with zombies and Foo Girl. And then she pulls out that baseball bat out of her shirt.
Which makes no sense, because you see something
that
indicates there's a baseball bat there, but...
Yeah. And, let's see.
First half. It sort of seemed like it was trying to play it serious most of the time. It just has sort of the gag of her not actually staying, just having, you know, cut work time so she could, accommodate... the work she does in her manga and her assistant work. And I just thought it was funny how everyone just was like, oh, well, let's get out of here. And they just, like, the one guy, Smelia, just takes back the manga. He wants to take back the manga, but she's, like, backing up away with it.
Yeah. Yeah, that was... And that manga, the pole panda and the sex positions. That was just... Oh, that was... weird.
And then I was like, I saw that, I was like, what? And then there was the in the second episode, I found it funny how she like kept on imagining the
Oh,
reactions
yeah.
to how like her dressing up.
And then that whole god of, what was it, like garbage or something with that just appeared like her. And then she starts with the whole Tony like being tougher or something.
And I was like, what it is, and then when she calls the three girls over when they come over,
Oh yeah, and then she's all
she's like, oh, it's like how horrifying she is in male form.
yeah. And then when she picks up Foo Girl and is
And there's like
like
the tongue face, like.
and let's go into the other room to do nice things to each other. Oh God.
And then you just pretty much find out that the main guy has a glasses fetish.
Yeah, the main character. Yeah. Honestly, the series does have pretty fun characters all around. But let's see. Anything else to comment about this week's episode, though?
Not that I can think of.
Yeah. All right. I guess moving on, you guys can talk about Grisaia.
Pretty good episode. It was so much better done than the last episode.
Yeah, and even then, it still felt rushed.
To me, it
Yeah, a
was
little
actually,
less, though.
and that's the thing. I thought overall the pacing with her, what's her name again?
Sachi?
Yeah, I
Yeah.
thought the pacing was overall much better done. And to me, I personally thought it fit better as one episode. It's just like you still get the feel. I'll agree with you that you still get the feeling that this would be so much better developed if it was more than one core or more than one season that they're doing.
I really, really wish it was two core.
But
But at least it seems like the next character arc's gonna get two episodes because the next one's like part one or something.
I don't remember. I'm not sure if I even stuck around for the episode preview. So I don't really just skip the credits most of the time. What'd
Yeah,
you think?
I thought it was really well done. Like, I liked how, like, I would say the thing I think was done best in that episode was when she was trying to sit there and run back to her parents, and then that just look of just like utter being destroyed on her face.
Yeah.
Like, you
Oh,
could
that's pretty
just
good.
tell, light went out of her eyes and everything.
Yeah.
That was depressing as hell.
Yeah. And also the part where she reads the birthday card that they can give her. Or that they before they died they had intended to give her. Or at least I think it was a birthday card.
Yeah, and something JJ will remember. It's kind of like the end of Katami's arc in Clannad.
Katami's arc. Which character? Oh yeah, Katami.
With the
Was it the one?
suitcase and
Oh
all
yeah,
that.
suitcase. I don't remember liking that. I mean, I remember not really liking that part actually.
But yeah, it was kind of done like that. I really did. I really enjoyed the new episode.
Yeah, me too.
Anything else about the Grisaia? All right, I guess moving on. Did you watch this week's The Seven Deadly Sins, Alex?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, there was. They had a lot of pretty good character development for Ban, I think. I thought.
Yeah, me too. But I would say the one thing that's sort of evident that you got through the episode, you could already sort of see what's coming with what's her name? How King thinks that, he killed her,
Yeah.
but you could see, especially with some of the foreshadowing in this episode, you could see what's coming next episode,
Yeah.
essentially. At least
Yeah.
that's what I think, but.
Maybe, but yeah, probably.
And that's sort of the odd thing. I never expected them to build up Ban as quickly as they
Yeah, I
decided
was kind
to.
of surprised, like he surprising since they basically just added him like last episode and now they're already pretty much building up his character. Which is surprising, considering this is a shonen series. So, yeah. But it'll be interesting to see. And of course, Donna is still awesome. And the whole thing with King basically.
I thought it was hilarious. I was just pretty much crushing on Diane.
Yeah.
Or Dion, or whatever they call her in the show.
Don. I think it's Donna.
I wonder what had like. What exactly do you think happened to King that he became pretty much like
I'm
a child?
I'm not sure.
He was like either like lost like a super amount of weight, or maybe he was in another body.
Yeah.
And like spirit got like transferred or something like that.
Could be.
So I was trying to figure out. I was like, he's in also in the same. Like, was he wearing the same clothes?
Maybe.
I also thought the part was funny when it was a flashback to them remembering when they were still together.
And
Van was just like sleeping on the plushies or the stuffed dolls that they had. And I just wonder, like, is King just supposed to be like some like really generous guy?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I'm sure would he be greed?
Van is greed.
Oh, yeah.
King, I think. Is he either gluttony or...
Well, gluttony makes sense, giving his old form. Or giving his old form, yeah.
But he seemed... But honestly, in the previews, he always seemed more like sloth to me, so I'm not sure. But, you know.
So what's the order...
What?
What's the order again? Van is greed.
Melodis is wrath. King is... Donna is envy. King is either like sloth
like
or,
sloth or
gluttony, and yeah. I think there was a character called Mordred or something that's supposed to be lust, and I can't think of who is pride. I mean, it's entirely possible that Hawk ends up being like the gluttony sin of the group.
The one part that was hilarious is when they were talking in the it was something that Hawk said, and Elizabeth and Meliodas just like stared at him for like five seconds. I can't remember what exactly it was he said.
I don't remember what that part, but I remember when they're in the dream world
no animals allowed in the restaurant, and you know, coming from an animal that can talk.
Yeah.
Essentially.
Yeah. But the thing I remember is when they're finally going into the whole Kingdom of the Dead place, and they're all talking about things they remember, and it's like Melodis is like, I don't remember anything. I wouldn't remember anything.
That actually, one of the best lines is like that came from this episode was, "If heaven or if the afterlife doesn't exist, why don't we all just kill ourselves?" And like I was cracking up at that part.
Yeah.
It just like says that like nonchalantly. It's like.
Yeah. And, like, Melodis and Diana are, like, or Dion, I mean, are, like, neither of them are really thinking of anything. And I think Elizabeth is, like, I think it was, like, about her mother, but she didn't have really strong memories about it. And then Hawk is, like, the only thing I remember is that homemade bread I once ate. The strongest memory. I thought that was pretty funny. Overall, it was a pretty good episode, and I'm definitely looking forward to the next episode. Especially with that, the chick, Holy Knight at the end.
Yeah.
She looked like she'd be pretty interesting of a character.
Yeah. Or she seems like one of those crazy kind of people who's like, I must do what's right to the Holy Knights or whatever, for the Holy Knights or whatever.
Yeah, it could be that too. But, yeah, overall, it was a pretty solid episode. All right, a movie.
Alex, I have one more thing I want to ask you about Grisaia.
Mm-hmm.
Is it just me, or was it completely infuriating when Sachi was trying to get them out of the classroom? Like, I can't tell if they were just being their normal, like, idiotic selves, or if it was, or if Yuji told them to play dumb.
That's what I was wondering, too. Because, like, you know, unless they were told beforehand, it's not like they would have really had any idea what was going on. But that's the thing. Did he give them instructions? Or, I don't know. I agree that was sort of just a sort of weird part of the episode. It's like,
yeah,
why?
They were just acting completely oblivious to it.
It's like, and especially not really picking up on just It's like, you must be doing something. I'm especially shocked that the one, what's the name? The, pocket, the box cutter chick. I'm surprised she, of all people, didn't, like, look under one the main desk. Because she seems like that, you know, to be that type of character that's like, sees that something's up.
Well, to be fair, Miji specifically mentioned to her at one point that, he wanted her to help him when it was time.
Mm-hmm.
So, if he had told it, just one of them, it would have probably been her. And the other ones do seem like the oblivious types who wouldn't pick up on that. Oh, and I just remember that she pissed herself. Why? Why, man?
It was like, the strangest, one of the weird things, that was like a fucking 10-foot flood of it. It's like, holy shit.
She must have went for the big gulp. I'm pretty sure that was just a fan service scene just so they could show her changing panties afterwards.
Yeah.
See what you're missing out on, JJ?
I think I got enough of urine from Knights of Cydonia.
You also get enough urine from whenever you play D&D, I guess.
To be fair, we haven't had Sin on in a while, though. I think Tyler is. I think
he
I got.
You for a taller man.
Oh God. Oh. Well, I think I cut Tyler into making a choose your own adventure codex story.
I would so read that.
Oh God.
It'll no, you gotta have Sid help write it.
I should probably tell Tyler to grab Sin as an advisor on that.
Oh my God. You'd go insane after reading it.
Pretty much.
You would be Odek.
You would be a follower of Odek. No, you would turn into a piss demon. Oh God.
Why?
We have a lot of messed up.
Tradition.
We have a lot of, in our campaigns, we have a lot of messed up stuff. Even our first campaigns, we had, like, the Demon of Slaanesh, a.k.a. the Rape Demon. Oh, God. And to be fair, that was our sane DM who came up with that. Eventually broke, I might add.
Question this whole sane thing.
Oh God! And I'm supposed to be the sanest of their group, and even I do terrible stuff. Oh God. Anyways, back on track. What were we talking about?
We were initially talking about, I think, Seven Deadly Sins, was it?
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, we were about to move on, and then interrupted for more Grisaia.
Yeah. Let's see.
Then my phone interrupted as usual, so.
As expected. Let's see. What did you think of the last Lord Marksman and Vanadis, Alex?
I thought it was pretty good.
Actually,
I would say maybe the pacing was a little bit quick.
Yeah.
And quicker than they need to be, but when you're only working on one season, what can you do?
Yeah.
But, I thought the battle was pretty good. I'm trying to remember exactly everything that happened. I know one thing that stuck out was, again, piss poor horse animation.
Oh, yeah.
There's literally one, I was actually talking about it to my brother, or with my brother. And at the one part when the horse is, like, going up a hill.
Oh, yeah.
It's like a flicker version. I'm not sure if you guys ever watched Looney Tunes when you were growing up.
Yeah,
but
did.
There's always older. It's when it's like sort of like Robin Hoodish or like King Time, like kingly stuff, middle aged ones that they would have Bugs Bunny in.
Yeah,
because they sometimes would have a horse riding. It's like it's like skipping in the air instead. And that's
what
one of the horses looked like in the episode.
It kind of reminded me of like that one scene in Ghost Stories where they're talking about how bad the animation is and how, like, my feet are moving, in the dub at least, my feet are moving, but I'm not going anywhere.
Okay, speaking of which, I'll save it for later since we'll be talking about what we watched, but, yeah.
Yeah.
Just again, also, they had the whole rocking horses problem.
Yeah.
As I'm just trying to figure out where they're like, it's like you said, this show doesn't look that great. I don't find it nearly as offensive as you do, but
well, even
I'm trying to figure out where,
I,
like, the CG parts probably obviously, you know,
yeah,
they're doing like the whole like battle area.
Yeah.
That probably is where some of the funds are being funneled into, but I can't figure out where else they're devoting it. Because if there's one thing that's been consistently bad, it's the horse animation.
Well, to be fair, I don't imagine they were thinking they'd need to put much into this series, though. Again, they've probably put more into this series than World Trigger ever got from Toei, which is sad. But I imagine they are probably funneling it away from the horse animation, but to be fair, some of their more, like, when they do action, it doesn't look half bad comparatively.
No, I'd say for most part, it was good, but
yeah.
So going back to the pacing, I'll say even the decision Vorn or Tigra did to, like, you know, actually shoot at the maid chick, can't remember her name, Tita.
Yeah.
It seemed very hasty. It's just like,
yeah.
It was like, sure, I'll do this, whatever. Or, like, he's like saying, I have to just get this right, is all.
Yeah. It did seem hasty, but at the same time, I like that it was sort of, didn't go the traditional route, at least.
And I'm also wondering what's going to happen, because the dude with the sword, I can't remember his name, Black Knight. You know, he obviously can't fight, he's probably going to be trapped there for a time.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering if they're going to try to get him to listen to what they think is going on.
I don't think so, because I don't think he's really a major character in it so much as, like, then again, now that I think about it, maybe they could, but yeah, I'm not really sure about that, because it could be that he's just like a minor character, sort of, that just to show some progress for the other characters, but at the same time, they could get him on his side, and he could just probably be a part of their forces, or maybe try to convince the king or something. So it could go either way, I think.
Yeah.
But, let's see. I can't really think of anything else from this week's episode.
Neither can I.
Alright, I guess moving on, you guys can talk about Inou-Battle.
That rant was probably, I think, the most well-done scene I've seen in an anime in a long time.
And it's sort of well-earned, too, because the way he was just sort of ducking her questions. It's like sort of, and it's how it sort of builds up, like, you know, it shows that she's never really understood the whole Chernobyl stuff, or like the things that Ando is into. So
yeah, you could just feel all the pain and suffering in her voice, and you could see that she sat there and memorized all that stuff for years and years trying to understand her best friend, but she just couldn't figure it out.
Yeah. And actually, when I was watching that part, it just sort of made me think back to something Adam said when he was on the show a couple weeks ago, is that, you know, it would be so much simpler for some of these characters to just talk. All Ando had to really say is that, you know, he was told not to talk to anybody about what he was talking to the one red-haired chick, right? About her her light novel. All he had to say was, you know, I'm not allowed to talk about it, or she doesn't want me to talk to anybody about it. But yeah,
like someone on Reddit said, he kind of went into his I gotta help this person mode as soon as she wouldn't write her light novel, so he just kind of forgot about Hitoko.
Yeah. And sort of thing, she's pretty much, especially in the last couple of episodes, it's obviously not intentional, because, you know, I don't think if put to it, Ando would choose any one particular girl that he prefers out of, you know, amongst his friends and all that. It's just that, like, you know, she's been getting the short end of the stick is the big problem in the last couple of episodes, obviously, because he's always spending his time with Tomoya lately.
Yep. And this week it all came out.
Yep.
Oh, apparently the Seiyu did that all in one take without any retakes.
Yeah, I read that when you I saw that you said that.
That is,
and even though even more, that's pretty impressive too. Like, I'll admit, I would say when I find sort of like word repetition or like phrase repetition, that for example, some of it done in Toradora as well as this past episode of Inou-Battle, I find it like it veers to the overdramatic. But overall, I thought it was a great part. Her just like yelling at him. Because it's just sort of, you know, it's like out of nowhere. She's off. She's just frustrated because of that. And I just thought this was an overall really good episode.
Yeah, this is probably headed towards probably 8.75 out of 10.
And then, what was I going to say? Then eventually you just had both of them realizing they're sort of like regretting the way they went about it.
Yeah, you could especially see that, like, you could see just the pain, just the defeat in his face once he realized that she was right.
Yeah.
And she gets kidnapped at the end, so I'm really hoping that they pull off the next episode well.
It really depends, because based on the preview, I'm almost convinced that it's going to be possibly a more humorous episode. Because, I don't know, the way it seemed like, it just seemed like one giant Chunin battle is coming up. But I don't know. For all I know, it could be some, like, super dramatic episode.
It's absolutely live.
Or it could be, like, Katanagatari episode 3's preview for 4. Where it's, like, you have one thing in the preview happening, like, really cool. And then in the episode itself, absolutely nothing in the preview was there.
He said it was like 5 minutes of like fighting, and then there was like absolutely nothing the rest of the way, right?
Basically, I don't want to spoil it, but in the preview for the episode 4, it's like this really awesome battle between the Shiniki, I can't think of his name, and this one sword guy who actually you see a little bit in the episodes before, like just a tiny bit in a somewhere else part, but in the preview you see them fighting, and there's just awesome stuff happening, like him parting waters with a slash of his sword and cutting a shark in the middle of the air and stuff. And just this really cool sword fight. And then when you get to the episode itself, you mainly focus on his sister, which I won't spoil anything about, but it's rather unexpected. Honestly, the episode itself actually was pretty enjoyable, but it's not what you expect if you just saw the preview for it. Yeah. And, wait, were we talking about Inou-Battle?
Yep.
Yeah.
Alright. Anything else to comment on Inou-Battle?
Not that I can think of.
Not too much.
Although I did, like, the whole, did they do another, like, combo Chunibyo attack? Somewhere in Nando?
I'm trying to remember. Yeah, that was, like, the stupidest thing ever. They were getting way too into it, too, and then she's just like, what the hell are you having me do?
I love that face. It's like her head just comes like enormous. She's like, what the hell? But yeah, go ahead.
It seems like Trigger's charm is shining more and more through as the series goes on.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think Hatoko might actually be one of my favorite characters at this point. As long as they don't just try to ruin the characterization later on.
Yeah. Is this only a 12 episode series?
Yep.
So whatever happens next, episode has a chance of being rushed, for all we know.
Yeah, I don't know. It doesn't seem like they have too much that they need to rush through for real.
Hmm.
Like, as opposed to something like Grisaia, where you could tell that they just have a ton more they need to tell during the story. Yeah, I'm excited to see where it goes on.
Alright, let's see. Any other series you've been watching this week in simulcasts?
Shirobako had a really good episode this week.
What happened? Oh, yeah. I think I remember hearing about that. Didn't it, like, show an actual chart of what your typical animator actually makes.
I can't remember. I know it was actually just a really good character episode because it focused on one of the girls, Emma. And because she's pretty much like struggling with trying to between speed of the work and quality of the work at this point. And it's actually going to be branching into the next episode too. Also, one thing I forgot to mention about Denki-Gai, the like little pie chart of I can't remember what it was, but it was hilarious because I had to stop to read what exactly it was.
Yeah, that's the chart I was talking about earlier.
Yeah, I just linked it in the chat, and the A-list voice actor apparently gets just way out the water compared to even the directors and stuff.
Yeah.
Huh.
And then the animator gets 9.4K. That is depressing.
Yeah. And let's see. Anything else about Shirobako?
Nah.
Alright. Any other series in simulcasts? Alright. Let's move on to other anime we've been watching. So, how about you, Stranger?
Like I said, the only one I've watched was the first episode of Gunbuster. I watched that with Chris. Which I thought was decent, but you could tell it was just, like, godly old. It was really cheesy. But, yeah, I'm only one episode in, so there's not really too much I can say about it.
Alright. That's it for you?
Yep.
Alright. Me, I have been watching a series called The 12 Kingdoms, and it's from 2002, and it's by Piero Studio Piero, and admittedly, the animation can also be a bit inconsistent, like Adam mentioned with like Naruto. But the thing I really like about the series is it basically does one of the most amazing character 180s I've seen since, say, Simon from Gurren Lagann. Like, the basic premise of the series is, like, three high school students end up thrown into a sort of an Asian fantasy land encounter to their own after a giant bird attacks the protagonist and they're taken away by a strange person, a man. And, the thing about it, though, is the character development is really, really good. Like, I'm only in, like, seven episodes, or no, let me start up. The protagonist, Yoko, she started out really aggravatingly dumb and all kinds of annoying. Like, she was really pissing me off. She's kind of has the whole, oh, I have to do X so other people will be happy or something, and basically thinking of other people before herself. But the series, like, the first couple of episodes are basically entirely about basically tearing her down and, like, her facing betrayal after betrayal and just fundamentally shifting her character to where she's only really thinking about herself rather than her other people anymore. And just the way they do it, she goes from aggravatingly annoying to just freaking awesome in I'm only seven episodes in, and she still has room for character development, and she's already really awesome of a character. And, I'm definitely going to keep more up with this series, because it really is pretty good, honestly. Especially for a series that came out way back in 2002. Like, the whole thing I mentioned before with the animation being inconsistent, like, sometimes It looks pretty good for a show that came out in 2002, but other times not so much. But the way it does it, it just works for the series, I'd say. But yeah. And that's all I've been watching. How about you, Alex?
Like I said, I started on a Kawa Under the Bridge in the
Shaft.
Yep. Started that, and I also started the Ghost Stories dub.
How far in the dub have you gotten?
I only watched one episode, but I was already cracking up because especially the lady, I think her name is the person Monica Rial plays, who pretty much sounds exactly like Hyatt.
Yeah,
from,
Momoko, I think.
Yeah. I found it hilarious and completely random. I was like, have you accepted our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, into your life? And it matches so well because the girl's eyes just, like, pop for some reason. And I was just, like, cracking
that's
up.
That's basically entirely her character. Or
and I was just, found it, I found it so, so messed up, which is so mean. And they had her main chick's little brother,
yeah,
supposed to be, they make him a retard, right?
Yeah,
and they just had, sometimes like he would talk normally sometimes, but then like when they're in danger, he just like had these like random,
yeah,
it's like moans like that, and I feel bad for doing that by the way, but
and it just gets more and more absurd and hilarious as it goes along.
And I was just like thinking of that first episode. I was wondering. How many takes did they have to do some of that stuff in? Because it was probably just improvised for some of the times, right?
I imagine so, yes.
I was just like wondering, how many times were they just laughing their asses off?
Probably a lot.
I was like, I'm trying to remember that one part is like, or especially the one part later in the episode where it's like, were those trees there? Tell me I'm a high. Am I high or were those were there trees there before? And then also when they're running away from whatever it was in the beginning, it's like something about monsters being Republicans and we're not voting age yet.
Yeah,
it just seems completely brilliant. Just how random they got with a dub.
Yeah, it gets way more random as it goes on. Like they eventually just stop caring about whatever the original plot is and just outright start making fun of it, and then randomly mention a whole bunch of different people like Reverend Wright and just it's so freaking random and hilarious of a dub.
And even more about Momoka in the show is that like anything is like thank you Jesus. It's like just everything is involving God for her. It's like, I'm sorry I had to use this devil book. It's a sign from our Lord. She must have had fun doing that role.
I imagine so. Like, I'd say right behind Tomoko from Wadamote, it's probably my second favorite role that Monica Rial has done. Just absurd, over the top, like everything she says has something to do with religion or God or something, which makes it more funny in one of the later episodes when she comments on one of the ghost's ass. And it's like, I think one of the quotes was, "Do you know what the definition of bootylicious is?" or something along that line, and it just makes it more hilarious.
Yeah, it's just funny because it did seem like they were trying to stick with some of the story in the first episode, and it's sort of encouraging that they just go with reckless abandon eventually. I would say the most consistently hilarious thing just throughout the episode is just Monica Rial speaking about God.
Yeah, and they just like literally they stop caring about the plot eventually and just start making fun of it. Like, I think they make a number of comments on, like, okay, how many times have we ripped off the ring so far? And to be fair, they do rip off the ring a lot. Like,
what makes the whole dub so much better is that apparently I read something that the original, the people who made the anime were perfectly fine with it. They were fine with the dub after, and this is after people complained about it too. That the people who, they're like perfectly fine with how what was it, ADV films?
I thought it was Aniplex, but well, it might have been ADV. Yeah.
Well, either way, the original creators were just were okay with the dubbers over here just doing whatever they wanted. And was there a reason given? Is like they just think the whole story was just too stupid?
I imagine so, because just the way it's set up, it really does feel like it's ripping off so many stuff, and it just and some of the later plots don't even make sense. Like the headless horse, or headless, basically Ghost Rider or whatever he is. They even outright comment on the storyline on how it just doesn't plain up make any sense. And just to be fair, the storyline, even with the dub, just plain up didn't make any sense at all. And most of the time, they really are pretty much ripping off other stuff in the storyline.
And moving on, where I only watched one episode of that, I watched three episodes of Adakawa on the Bridge because I enjoyed it so much when I was watching. It's hilarious. It's just brilliant slice of life insanity, essentially. And it's sort of made better by the main character. The main character, one of the things that, what it's supposed to be with him is that he's pretty much like, you know, rich. He is pretty much set up to succeed in life. And one of the things, the tenets of his family is something that his father enforces to him is that make sure you don't owe anybody. Essentially, look out for yourself. And so, he winds up being saved by this one girl who's like, you know, the main girl of the series, or what implies pretty much so far at least. And because what happens is that she saves him, and he winds up having to become her, they pretty much wind up even in the first. From the first episode, he says, you know, I'll be your, like, lover or something like that. So it's pretty much he's taking it to extreme. And the really funny scene in the first episode, like, a couple minutes in, the how far his father takes it is, like, it's like when he's, when the main character is 3 years old, and so his father is, like, dressed up as a baby, and it's like, come and feed me and all that. It's like, you have to take care of me because I took care of you when you were a baby. It's like, it got to that far, and I was just like, I was dying. And that was hilarious. And I actually think you both like the series, but I actually would say it's something more so along your lines, JJ.
I think I remember trying it once, but then sort of not. I don't remember. It might have just been I was selecting it with an. Deciding between it and a number of other series is, and I think I went with something else.
And it's, you know, it's sort of a, some of the reactions especially are just were hilarious. And some of the characters are just like completely random. They have this one guy, this one like, they have like masks, because pretty much it's like a bunch of people who are like homeless. And they're all living under the, this one, a bridge, that the, I guess it's the Arakawa River runs through, and it's like pretty much, you know, it has all these characters. This one guy is dressed, he's supposed to be a cop, but you could tell he's just like blatantly dressing as one, and pretty much the main character points it out. And then this one guy, his name is Sister, and he's like pretty much holds mass, and he has to be like some like commando guy just like hiding from some something, because he's like all right, everybody step up for mass. It's like, have any of you sinned? And he's like, at the same time, pulls out a Uzi and just shoots it into the sky, because pretty much implying he's just gonna shoot people if you've been a bad. He's like, have any of you been a bad person? Yeah, I'm already really enjoying him. Unless I choose to watch Gintama or something tonight, I'm probably gonna be watching more.
All right. Anything else?
Nah, nothing I can think of.
All right.
By the way, did you ever watch a Sabagebu OVA?
Not yet. Terrible.
You gotta watch it, because I really want your opinion on the OVA.
Yeah, I've really been behind since school and stuff, but I suppose Thanksgiving break is coming up, so I'll probably have more time. to work on stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I'll probably, if not later on this week, I'll probably watch it over break then.
Actually, Stranger, one thing I forgot to mention is more so relevant to mine and Stranger's interests. And back on with the things we were doing this week, I actually got back to reading Restart of the Wheel of Time series. I wanted to just mention that before you went to news and recommendations.
How long, or how far into it were you before you restarted it? Or did you finish it?
Well, I finished it, but I just, I've been just trying to figure out what to do lately, like, just sort of in, like, free time, so I just decided to pick up the first book again. And I think I'm 10 chapters in already.
I've actually been considering doing the same because I've been listening to the Blind Guardian song a lot, and it's been making me want to pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
I still got all the hardcover set on the on my bookshelf over there.
But yeah.
Yeah. Okay, then. I guess if we have nothing else to talk about in anime, we shall move on to news. And let's see, the first news topic I have is apparently the Amagi Brilliant Park light novel sold around
200,000.
I thought I had 100,000, but it might have been 200,000 copies in about like 2 weeks after its TV anime started. So that's pretty impressive. And let's see. Other news I have is Season 2 of Knights of Sidonia has been scheduled for spring season 2015. And the first trailer for the Ghost in the Shell online FPS has been revealed. And it, well, as a fan of the series, it looks really freaking awesome, I think. And, well, honestly, I honestly would have preferred like a Deus Ex style RPG for the universe. Considering how good it looks, I'm more than happy with the team-based FPS that it is. Any other news you guys want to talk about?
I thought of something that I forgot. I can't remember, never mind.
Okay.
Well, I heard there's an adaptation of a manga called Koe no Katachi. And it sounded like it would be pretty interesting.
Yeah.
My brother and sister read that. Also, the first trailer for Shokugeki no Soma got released.
Wait, it has? Oh, I'll have to check that out later.
But yeah, the description for Koe no Katachi is somewhere. Like, the main character bullies a deaf girl to the point that she drops out of school. As a result, he is ostracized and bullied himself with no friends to speak of and no plans for the future. This is the story of his path to redemption. Sounds like it's going to be pretty interesting drama.
Yeah.
I don't think it sounds like something you'd like.
Probably not. Alright.
Actually, I just realized we forgot to talk about, I can't understand what my husband is saying.
I sort of missed today's episode, actually.
Never mind.
Yeah, I haven't seen the new one either.
Never mind, then.
Alright. I guess moving on, games or VNs we recommend. So, let's see. How about you, Alex?
I'm just gonna re-recommend Deus Ex, being that I've just completely been obsessed with it over the last 2 weeks. So, like I said, it's dated. Like, the more and more I played it, the more I realized that certain elements, you know, you could tell it's sort of rough to deal with today. Especially, the one thing that always bothered me is the inability. Like, as far as I knew, you can't manually reload your gun. You always had to use up the ammo before it reloaded for you.
I don't remember that part. I thought you could reload your weapon.
I don't remember ever having an option to reload.
You might have.
Did you check the options?
Because
I meant to check that, but like I said, it never mentioned anything in the tutorial about it, and you would think in the tutorial it would tell you how to reload.
I honestly don't remember ever having that problem with the game.
Either way,
I could have sworn you could reload your weapons.
Well, I don't know. I just swear, at no point, I remember trying to press R to do it. I remember...
It might have been a different key, but I remember there being a reload button, honestly. Oh yeah, I remember now. It wasn't on R, but it was on a weird key for some reason.
Oh, either way, it's just sort of an inconvenience for throughout the entire time, not knowing exactly, not having your like normal
I
reload
think it
thing,
was
sort of
like
bit of an
T
inconvenient.
or X or something.
It's a bit of
Something
an
weird like that.
It's a bit of an inconvenience not having it where it
Yeah.
should be.
Yeah, that's
Because
it's
I
definitely
was
should
saying,
be.
I believe System Shock pretty much had, the reload where it needed to be.
Yeah.
So,
Yeah, I think I remember it being in an odd place.
but also, just the gunplay in general, I sort of preferred doing stealth most of the time.
Yeah, that's the thing about. I usually did prefer stealth, but I didn't really care for the stealth in the game, if I remember right.
Actually, that was fine for
Or at
me.
least the non-lethal weapons weren't that great. At least
But
that.
actually, I just the one thing I forgot to mention in the last couple weeks is that the Dragon's Tooth sword is arguably the most overpowered
Oh
thing.
yes,
You
it
can,
is.
you're literally just besides some enemies that'll take two hits, most of the enemies you kill in one hit.
And that's
And even
without
when you
it.
don't, yeah, even when you don't even have to be a master at the what's it called?
The melee skill or
The melee skills and all
yeah.
that. You could just take people out in one hit.
Pretty much, I remember
So.
investing in like gun skills and stuff, and I picked up the sword and I basically still one hit most enemies.
I got a couple of the stuff to master level, but
Yeah,
yeah.
the experience was it definitely was more unusual since you usually had to do like find hidden areas and stuff to gain experience points and stuff.
Also, one thing I forgot to mention, I didn't get the Gep gun until later in the game,
The Gep Gun.
which pretty much it's a rocket launcher
Oh
essentially,
yeah, the rocket.
and that's actually pretty strong too,
Yeah, but
from what I
just
remember.
but the Dragon's Tooth basically is a katana lightsaber.
It's to me, it's I couldn't help but think it was a little out of place.
Yeah.
Somewhat. It's like, I know this is like a technological, like tech future and everything. It's like, apparently we have lightsabers.
Yeah.
That's essentially what it is. So.
Yeah, the one thing I do like about the original game is how much it allowed in for like more prequel stuff to happen, like Human Revolution. You have basically cyborg characters in the background and stuff, but most of the main characters have advanced to nanites and stuff. So you just have this background stuff right there that you could expand upon, which they did with Human Revolution. Plus, of course. And of course, the best part about the game is how fluid the dialogue felt to me. Like, when you actually did something, the characters actually felt like they were reacting to your actions. Which is actually something I wish was done more nowadays. 'Cause even still
Well,
today,
that and
yeah.
actually good reflections in a game.
Yeah. Yeah, that too.
Which
But
shouldn't
just.
be, this shouldn't be even needed to be said. I mean, for Christ's sake, it's 2014, and some people still can't get reflections right. Whereas a game from 1999, 2000, is like, you have like perfect reflection, essentially.
Yeah. But yeah, the main thing I really wish more games did was the dialogue system from Deus Ex, where if you actually do something, characters will respond to that, and it actually made it feel more. It actually f made the world more fluid, it felt. Which is something that bo tends to bother me, like, especially in RPGs, where if you pick up something, nobody will comment whatsoever on your actions. Like, loot place or kill somebody and stuff. It just tends to take you out of the immersion of the universe. Yeah.
I was like, never mind, this guy's just busting in my house doing all the whatever he wants.
And like, if you do an action in the past, it usually doesn't have much of any consequence, even if it's like unless it's like something major that's major in the game's plot, you usually won't have people commenting on your more, like if you do a smaller quest that has some effect somewhere, it usually wouldn't peter over to anywhere else, it's quickly forgotten. And I kind of wish they would make it felt like your actions mattered more. Honestly.
Moving on, one of the things that's always a good strong point for games for me, sometimes that also had a great soundtrack. I loved a lot of the music.
Oh yeah, that music was really good, especially the menus music.
Yeah. I was actually the thing is with the main menu thing, as kick-ass as it is, it reminded me of the old X-Men cartoon.
Yeah. And I think Human Revolution, if you wait after the credits, they'll do a remixed sort of version of that menu song, which was a nice ode to the original. Especially
even the Human Revolution's main theme, Icarus.
Yeah,
that's a good theme too.
Plus,
and just the menu theme. There's also the very sort of like it's more of a ambient, the ambient main menu theme. Yeah. I love it.
Yeah, and actually, Human Revolution, if you wait after the credits, there's sort of a, I think it was either, I can't remember if it was a actual scene or if it was just a black screen.
It's a post-credit sequence with, like, text. And it's pretty much, talking about Paige.
Yeah. And basically carries over into the original, sort of.
And it's just sort of funny. I actually made the Helios decision simply to spite Paige, because I just couldn't stand him at the end.
Yeah.
The shit is like, oh, I'm going to be a god. Deal with this. Like, fuck you.
Yeah.
So, you know, I was like, whereas I wasn't sure what ending to go with. I was just like, you know what? Screw you, Bob Page. I'm taking this ending just to spite you.
Yeah.
Like, overall, what I would say about Deus Ex is, while, you know, I wouldn't say it's my favorite game, it is one of my favorite. Like, I would say I'd probably put it in my top 10 or top 20 now.
Yeah, definitely.
While it isn't my favorite game, it's one of those games, to me, having played it, that everybody needs to check out.
Pretty much, yes. Like,
regardless whether you're like, yeah, you gotta, I sort of think you should see what you think of the game.
For no other reason than how fluid some of the dialogue feels. Like, even today, not a lot of games can come close to what the original Deus Ex did with its writing.
Yeah, it was also, what's even more impressive about that is sometimes they never really had the best voice acting.
Yeah, I remember that. The voice acting was pretty subpar.
Especially the one lady in Hong Kong's like, J.C. Denton in the flesh.
Yeah, the dialogue with the voice actors weren't that great, but how well their writing was just made it so much better than a lot of games today, honestly. Just made it feel more.
Did you ever play the one on Xbox Deus Ex?
No, I only played.
It's on Steam. Because I was considering.
Oh, do you mean the second game?
Yeah.
Yeah, I only played a little bit of it before I dropped it. It's not really worth playing because it's generally regarded as a huge disappointment compared to the original.
I think the one I would probably skip over is The Fall, but I sort of just want to get it simply because, you know, I think after finally having played Deus Ex Human Revolution first and having finally played the original.
Yeah.
I actually really like the series.
Yeah.
So.
But in general, most fans consider it a bit of a huge disappointment, and I only got like an hour or so in, but yeah, I can definitely agree it was nowhere near as good from what I played. But, I personally don't recommend it, but I didn't get far enough to really tell, honestly.
That's all I got to say on Deus Ex. So.
All right. How about you, Stranger?
I am going to go ahead and recommend Civ 5, the Game of the Year version, because you can sit there and get sucked into that for hours and hours, and it's just horrendously addicting.
And you can get bombed by Gandhi.
Oh no, I always do come first.
I have not played the Civ series, but I always find that hilarious.
Yeah, they accidentally did something in the first game.
Yeah, I remember hearing about it.
Echo.
Okay.
Okay, it's working now. They messed up something in the first game where they accidentally set his...
Yeah, it's like...
His aggressiveness to using nukes to 12 out of 10.
I thought it was like at complete max, like over max or something.
Yeah, it was over max, 12 out of 10.
Yeah.
But yeah, whenever I play, I'm super defensive and rush science until I get nukes and then just rain hellfire upon everyone. I'm a evil, evil person in that game. And I cannot quit playing until every other civ is just dead. Like, I can't just go for the science victory or the culture victory. I gotta kill everyone. I'll be sending giant death robots after everyone.
Yeah.
The game's amazing.
Yeah.
Plus, there is so many mods to it.
I'm actually considering getting Beyond Earth during the winter sale at some point.
Yeah, I've heard it's not as good as Civ 5.
Well, it depends. I have to make up my mind which one I want to buy, because all you people have Civ 5 on Steam.
Yeah, I'd recommend Civ 5 first.
I played the demo of both, and actually for some reason was able to adjust easier to Beyond Earth. I mean, I still have absolutely no idea what I'm doing, but...
Yeah. All right. I'm going to recommend Noita Love 2 because it is easily the funnest action side scroller I've ever played. And it's only like $5 or, yeah, around $5 on Steam. And you can pretty much finish it in a couple of hours, but it is really fun. And I still go back to it every now and then. And let's see, moving on, anime we recommend. All right, how about you, Stranger?
I think I'm actually going to skip the anime recommendation and recommend the Wheel of Time series instead.
All right.
Because Alex got me back onto thinking about that. But if you must have an anime recommendation, I'm going to throw in Soul Eater 2. They had a disappointing ending, but the characters... aesthetic was really great.
Alright. Oh wait, what series was that you recommended?
The book series or the anime?
Anime.
Soul Eater.
Oh, Soul Eater, yeah, okay. And I'm going to go a different route as well and recommend the Spirit Circle manga instead of an anime. And the basic premise of the series is basically, the main male character and female character have been reincarnated for, like, I think it was 7 times. But the thing is, though, in each incarnation, they usually end up killing one of or the other or both at the same time. Though it's usually the female character who gets the short end of the stick, regardlessly. And the main character basically has to relive each of his past lives in order to figure out why the main female character hates his guts so much, which requires him to going back to all the way to his very first incarnation. Now, one of the things the series does that I find interesting is it kind of reuses its cast in the different settings. And it seems like... almost like Tsubasa Chronicles kind of did, only it's less very different universes and more past lives and stuff. So often you find yourself getting re-endeared to the characters in different ways each arc. But the main thing the series really does have going for it, it's very feels heavy. Like, each arc, especially Vans, feels like mini after stories in some ways to me, at least to me. Like, you basically watch some of the characters move on with their lives and basically get old, deal with loss, and even have children sometimes. And have children.
And stuff. Now, what's this called?
Spirit Circle.
Because that sounds like it's right up my alley.
It's very enjoyable of a series, and It can get pretty dark and fun at times as well, but I definitely recommend it. And honestly, it is easily my favorite manga series I'm keeping up with right now, and I really do hope it gets an anime down the road, though. I hope it fir they first wait until they finish up all the arcs, because the way the manga sets it up, it really feels like there is a set amount of arcs it's going to have before it finishes up, and I think right now they're already on their fifth reincarnation, so there's like just another arc to go, and then there's the major arc of the very first guy, the very first incarnation. So yeah, I recommend the Spirit Circle manga, which you can read on Crunchyroll or wherever else. And let's see, how about you, Alex?
I'll second Strange's recommendation of the Wheel of Time series, but also recommend an anime. I'll recommend Hoseki no Rintetsu. Really good workplace.
Oh yeah.
If you're gonna dig workplace comedy with a distinct setting,
And dark humor.
yeah, you will love that series. And or yeah, I really when that was our. I'll admit they had like 2 or 3 week episodes, but I fell in love with that show when I was
Yeah.
watching earlier in the year.
That pervy man on some screenshot JJ keeps
Yeah.
posting is so freaking stupid and hilarious.
Wait, which one?
The pervy madams.
And the way that Hoseki basically announces that their name afterwards, it's just more hilarious in that episode.
But
And
yeah,
just yeah.
And Wheel of Time has all the brain pulling and sniffing you could ever want.
Yeah. All right. Is there anything else we wish to recommend?
nothing.
All right. Well, hopefully you enjoyed this week's episode of Divergence Cast. If you would like to contact any of us, we are all on Twitter, as well as this podcast is also on Twitter. Be sure to like this video and subscribe and share us with your friends. And of course, our ask.fm and my anime lists will be under the same username as our usernames from Twitter. Well, until next time, later.
Peace.
Peace.